welcome to Cinemastrophe. I'm Don Perignon, saving you from getting ripped off. And welcome back to Remake Month. Aren't we?
3 years ago, when I first started this show, I reviewed John Carpenter's The Fog. It was written by director John Carpenter and producer Deborah Hill, the dynamic duo that brought us such cinematic classics as Halloween, Halloween 2, and Escape from LA. If I remember correctly, and trust me, I really could be wrong about this, I felt that the movie was okay, although I really don't care enough to make sure. Point is, someone thought it was so good that it warranted a remake. That someone being Deborah Hill and John Carpenter himself.
You two are just gonna milk that story for all it's worth, aren't you?
Starts off with a ship on fire.
Look, I know Crossbones didn't do as well as anticipated, but that's no reason to burn the set down. Give it time, it'll grow on people.
Four men are rowing away from the blaze when their boat gets stuck on something in the water.
Something down there! Clear it away! I can't see anything!
Three men are rowing away from the blaze.
Appropriate song, except the movie's going down drooling and doing this.
Antonio Island is having a dedication ceremony to honor its forefathers, which you probably already guessed were the four men we saw earlier. The movie introduces us to their descendants, which is this lady here who has a daughter named Elizabeth, played by Maggie Grace. Insert your lost jokes here. The mayor here and his son, who is an alcoholic preacher. A radio DJ named Stevie, played by Selma Blair. And Superboy. I'm assuming this is after the death of Jonathan Kent, but before he joined the oil rig. Here he's gone by the alias of a charter boat captain named Nick. He and his first mate Spooner took a couple of guys. Really? His name is Spooner? Yeah, I really don't think he introduces him to the customers too often. Took a couple of guys out fishing and are heading back to inland when their anchor gets stuck.
Why must life be so hard?
Once it finally breaks free, it pulls up a sack and the contents of it spill out. Back on the mainland, this guy comes out and see a bunch of birds flying away. Oh my god, it's Birdemic all over again! Quick, go grab your coat hangers!
War.
Nick is on his way to see Stevie when he runs into his girlfriend, Elizabeth, who is supposed to be away at college.
Move over, Lois and Lana. There's some new pussy in town. Meow.
However, being the smooth operator that he is, she's none the wiser, and he takes her into town.
You know the difference between flotsam and jetsam.
God damn it, Crazy Ralph. One of these days, someone's gonna strangle you up against a tree.
He shows her the watch that fell out of the sack, which he found washed up on the beach. We won't even ask how it washed up on the beach so quickly. And she notices an engraved stamp, which seems familiar to her. Out on the boat, Spooner and Nick's cousin are with these two girls filming a Girls Gone Lame video when the fog rolls in, shorting out the boat and killing everyone on board.
You didn't see that, did you?
We find out that Elizabeth doesn't exactly get along with her mother, which means absolutely nothing to the film. Like them, I'm just padding out this review.
You're despicable.
She ends up staying at Nick's place for some super loving and tells him that she's been having nightmares lately about people burning and her drowning.
Oh, boo-hoo. Let me play a sad song for you on the world's smallest violin.
Unable to sleep, she looks up the engraved stamp on the computer when it shorts out.
Unless your name is Mary Jane and you're married to Peter Parker, when you see footprints on the ceiling, it's time to get the hell out of Dodge.
The next day, Stevie's son finds the hairbrush that fell out of the sack and gives it to his mom. Yep, nothing says I love you like an old shitty barnacle brush. Elsewhere, Elizabeth goes to the town museum where this guy tells her that the seal belongs to an old fort up north that used to trade with Shanghai up until 1871.
Nobody lived there after the outbreak.
What outbreak?
Leprosy. The Chinese brought it over. Wiped out half the island, the other half left by ship.
Damn! China just gives us all the shitty stuff, don't they? Leprosy, SARS, cheap controllers. They're really bad number two pencils.
Nick gets a call from his uncle saying that Spooner and his cousin went out on a boat last night and haven't come back, so Nick borrows his uncle's boat to go look for them. They find his cousin and the girls dead and Spooner hiding in the freezer.
And this is why 99% of black people don't set foot on a boat unless they're Somalian pirates.
So, of course, being the only survivor and the only black person in town, the mayor automatically assumes he did it, but Nick just doesn't believe it.
I was frozen today!
Nick found the camera that Spooner was using on the boat and thinks it might prove his innocence, so rather than give it to the police, he gives it to Elizabeth to keep safe.
You know, just in case Spooner is guilty, he can get rid of it and hope they let him go due to lack of evidence.
Looking at the footage, she sees that Spooner is innocent and, again, rather than running straight to the police with what she found, Elizabeth decides this is a great time to practice her balancing act.
Stupid! You're so stupid!
She finds an old journal hidden in the wall, and considering the tide fluctuation, it's a pretty stupid place to hide a journal.
It's pretty much like hiding ice cream in a pile of shit.
At the town's lighthouse, where Stevie hosts a radio station, while she's working, she hears a music box through the airwaves, a knocking and screaming, and then the brush her son found sets the wall on fire.
Whoa, that was pretty weird. Oh well, back to work.
Elsewhere, Elizabeth takes the journal to the preacher because his family's name is on it, and he basically tells her to get the fuck out of his face. Well, that's gratitude for ya. He probably tells people to suck his balls when they wish him a happy birthday.
Then again, he is a drunk, so when he says suck his balls, most likely he really means he wants you to suck his balls.
Later, she tells Nick about the footage she lost, and he seems a little bit upset about it.
Where's the tape? Let me see it.
I lost it.
You what?
I know. It fell in the water. when you were drowning in the seaweed?
I know how this sounds, okay?
Oh, well, we didn't really care about the black guy anyway. Time to find out what's written in that journal.
May God forgive my soul. I say these words, but in my heart I wonder, can God forgive any man for a sin as great as the one I'm about to commit?
If you're about to start Scientology, then no. No, he can't.
Night's a-brewing, which means it's time for the fog to come rolling in, which means it's time for some really stupid deaths. The first one is Crazy Ralph, who more commits suicide than is killed by the fog when he finds a ship rope and follows it out to sea.
Which is living proof, stupidity kills.
Stevie's son, having seen the whole thing, runs home being chased by the fog. Not really sure why he's running when the fog hasn't done anything yet. Maybe he's allergic to bad plot setup. Next to die is Weatherman Dan while Stevie watches through her webcam. Because the fog knocked out the phone line, she has no choice but to announce it over the radio.
Fire at the weather station. Dan has been killed. If anybody can hear me, please go check on my son. The phone lines are down. Please check on my son. There is something in the fog, please.
Something in the mist!
Elizabeth, get in.
What is it?
Stevie's son's in trouble. We gotta go.
Turn it on the radio. Come on.
You know, with someone who's supposed to be running to the rescue, he didn't sound like he was in all that much of a hurry.
Come on, we gotta go. But first, I gotta get gas. You hungry? Because I could really go for a burger right now. I'm starving.
Next on the chopping block is Stevie's aunt after getting a visit from Pestilence. Her son comes across the body and again somehow knows it's the fog. What is he, like that kid from The Sixth Sense?
I see fog, people.
He's trapped in his room, and just when it looks like all is lost, he pulls out the fog's one weakness.
Fog, not scotch tape! Little fucker, take the tape off this door right now! You hear me? Run down! I'm going to! Well, there isn't really much I can do with the scotch tape on the door, I guess. Well, okay, kid, you win. I'm leaving. I'm going now. Bye-bye. Open up this fucking door!
Nick shows up in time to save him from the old lady from Ghostbusters. Nice to see that she still got it. They all end up in the town museum where we find out the truth. The gang's forefathers had a deal with a group of lepers to sell them half the town's land. When the ship arrived, they stole all the gold and set the ship on fire with the lepers still in it.
Which is similar to Bloomberg's solution for New York's homeless problem. And telemarketers. Genocide! The one cure for everything!
After killing the preacher and Elizabeth's mom, the fog ghost dragged the mayor out into the graveyard. Nick and Elizabeth follow the mayor to watch him get burned alive. Well, I hope that was amusing for you.
And it keeps getting funnier every single time I see it!
Nick says they should leave, but Elizabeth, her clit having grown three sizes that day, decides it's time to confront the ghost face to translucent face.
Driving over the bridge to give you my keys. I know you don't love me, I know it ain't easy. Friends become lovers and lovers lose friends. It's when the fog rolls.